Thank you, Will. Powerful message in that song.
Amen.
Repeat it. Have your Bibles with you this morning. We're going to be reading from the book of 2 Peter, chapter 3. 2 Peter. If you're able, stand with me as we read from the Word of God. We'll begin reading at verse 1 of chapter 3 of the book of 2 Peter. This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure mind by way of remembrance, that you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. That's one of the biggest lies you ever hear.
Amen.
For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and the earth, which are now, by the same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Let's bow our heads for a moment. We're grateful this morning, Lord, for the word of God and for what it says to us. Teach us from it, and for that we will thank you. Amen. You may be seated. Jan Markle of Olive Tree Ministries, someone I'm coming to appreciate more and more, made me aware recently of an article in The Guardian that talks about a phenomena that is occurring among evangelicals that unfortunately is rapidly gaining ground, even here in our own country. Jan says the malady that I speak about goes by many names. End times weariness, rapture fatigue, or Israel burnout. The results are the same. The scoffers and the skeptics are gaining too much territory and too many followers. Too many that call themselves Christians. The message that the king is coming has become boring and just plain old news. Now, we've always seen scoffers like Peter is talking about here in our scripture reading. They have always been present. But now those scoffers are not so much coming from outside of the church, all they're still there, but more now are coming from inside of the church itself. How sad. I must admit that I never thought I would live to see it becoming this bad in the church itself. Now, the first book on Bible prophecy I ever read was Hal Lindsey's the great lake planet Earth. How many ever read that book? Am I the only person in this place that had ever read that? I remember Dave Hunt telling about how one night Hal Lindsey stood up in a Bible study in Dave's living room with pages in hand and declared that he believed God wanted him to write a book, to which they all urged him to do so. And after reading the late great planet Earth, I got hooked on studying Bible prophecy. And I have been earnestly watching for the Lord's coming ever since. I'd only been a Christian a few months when I read it, and really never heard anything in the church I grew up in about the Lord's coming, and just became fascinating with the thought that Jesus was coming back again. Now, I didn't understand everything that Hal Lindsey was talking about at the time, nor do I think even at this point that I completely agree with everything he said. But Hal made a believer out of me. But the fact that what Hal Lindsey wrote in his book, his 1969 book, the fact that it has not yet come to pass has caused many in the evangelical community to take a collective so what sigh. Haven't we waited long enough? They're now saying, if it is really going to happen, isn't it about time that Jesus gets here? That's what one hears in many circles today. Jan Markle summed up what the Guardian article said this way, and I quote, "The late great planet Earth and the Left Behind series prophesied a lot of things that have not yet come to pass. Haven't we waited long enough? Isn't it time to move on from this message?" Those who hung on to the words of the popular 1970s Larry Norman song, "I Wish We'd All Been Ready," Waylon sung so good this morning, I'm still one of those guys hanging on to them. They've also waited long enough. Not me. Life has always been filled with guns and war, and everyone gets trampled on the floor, as the song goes, but so what? Almost 45 years have passed, and the world is still groaning. I'm still quoting. It's time to move on. We've been through this before, has replaced apocalyptic fever. There's nothing new under the sun. Your words of warning are falling on deaf ears. Maybe you evangelicals have sided with the wrong players. Don't you know that hundreds of innocent Palestinians are being killed daily by apartheid Israelis? End time weariness, rapture fatigue, late great burnout. The chosen people have lost their chosenness. The article in The Guardian suggests all this and more. End quote. Now, I feel bad because I believe what they say is exactly how many Christians are acting toward the preaching these days that the King is coming. What a great song that was that Nazarene evangelist Chuck Milhoff wrote. "The King is coming." I may remember that one. Yeah, a lot of you remember "The King is Coming." But I haven't heard it sang for years in any kind of church, including the Nazarene. I think the last time I heard it sang, Chuck sang it in a Baptist church in Franklin where I went to hear him. I used to sing it, but I can't reach those notes anymore. Matter of fact, I asked Waylon, would he sing that or Larry Norman's song, and you see which one he chose. Two, nor do I have the wind to sing anymore. So the reason I don't sing it has nothing to do with not believing what it says anymore. I just can't sing it. If anything, I believe it more today than ever. But the date setters, like Harold Camping of Family Radio, who said the rapture was going to happen May 21st, 2011, for sure. And former NASA engineer Edgar Wiesenhunt, who wrote a book declaring 88 reasons why the rapture will be in 1988. And others like them have been foolish enough to set dates that came and went without a thing happening. And not only did those guys set dates, but when they were wrong, they reset dates. And people were dumb enough to believe them a second time. And all that hurt deeply the teaching on the rapture and the second coming a lot. Now, if I preach on it, there are some who will say, because of the date setters, all that nonsense again. Because they were taken in by the date setters before. Very few people, though, that listen to my radio program say that. I'll hear from them, man, we haven't heard any good preaching like that on the second coming in a long time. But the King is coming, whether anybody is ready, or whether anybody is still watching for him or not. He's coming. Amen. I don't know the day, nor the hour, nor does anybody else, but he's coming. Just the same. Now it's amazing how Peter in verses 3 through 4 of our scripture reading predicts that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts and saying just exactly what we're saying. Where is the promise of his coming? How would he know what would be happening today unless God told him? God's word, what God's word prophesies, always comes to pass. You know why? Because God knows the future.
That's right. Amen.
God knows what's going to happen down the road. And the presence of scoffers, like I read about, who are getting burnt out even in the church on preaching on the second coming, the presence of scoffers is a sign of the Lord's coming in itself.
Amen.
But who would have thought that so many of the scoffers of today would come from within the church itself? But the voices that many millennials are listening to in the church are no longer telling them that Israel is the apple of God's eye. They're no longer telling them that Israel is the key to the end of the age. Instead, many of these newer churches, they're hearing that Israel is illustrative of a new kind of apartheid. And that the Palestinians had their land stolen. And don't you know? The church is the new Israel. That's what the Catholic Church taught for years, and now more and more evangelicals are accepting that fact. Forget about that country over there that calls itself Israel. We are the new Israel. And all the promises in the Bible that are directed to Israel are not directed to that little hunk of land over there that's causing so much trouble. It's for us, the church. Baloney.
Amen.
The glorious message of the rapture and the second coming that years ago had nearly every Christian alive excited that today might be the day, now creates nothing more than a big yawn in the minds of many within the church. I can remember somebody telling me at Bible college when I first got started, just a few months after I'd been saved, I was in Bible college, and I can remember somebody saying that when you preach, you better have a good message on salvation. You better have a good message about sanctification. You better have a good message about the second coming. You preach about those things, you'll pretty much cover everything else that is in the Bible. But few preachers even bother to preach on the second coming anymore, or holiness, for that matter. And here we are now where it's really starting to get interesting. With things like moving the United States Embassy to Jerusalem. The aligning of the nations in the Mideast, just as Ezekiel 38 predicted they would be before the Russians invade Israel. The convergence of all the earthquakes and volcanoes going off like never before. Did you see this past week? They closed a major part of Grand Teton National Park.
Yep.
Because a great big fissure opened up in the ground from the Yellowstone volcano. All kinds of interesting things are happening in our day, and yet it excites only a tiny remnant in the church these days who refuse to grow weary of keeping our eyes on the sky. I hope you're still one of those. I am.
Amen.
I have never seen so many signs converging all at the same time as what is going on right now. Seismic activity seems to escalate each week, especially along the Ring of Fire. And mark my word, it will only, remember I said this, it will only be a matter of time before we witness a major seismic event right here in the United States. Probably in California. 6.0 earthquake right off the coast of Alaska just a couple days ago. And every day you hear it. Oh, you won't turn your TV on and hear it on the news. But it happens, and it's happening. Our planet is being shaken, not only physically, but all around the globe emotionally. And watch, there's going to be another great shaking. Thank God for everything that Trump's did.
Yep.
But we are in for another great financial shaking. Anyways, not anyways soon. Italy just fell apart financially in the last week or so. And in Venezuela right now, I read this past week, they had something like 4,500% inflation. A month's pay will now buy you 4 cups of coffee. Think of that. A month's pay will now buy you 4 cups of coffee. And it isn't going to take too much more to push it all over the edge. Jesus is coming soon.
Amen.
And Israel is still the apple of God's eye.
Amen. That's right.
Now, why hasn't the Lord returned by now? Many are asking. Not to scoff. They just want to know. Peter answers that question for us too in verse 9 of our scripture reading. Look what he says. He says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but he is long-suffering," that means patient, "to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance."
Amen. Yeah.
It's the love for the souls of your loved ones that are not yet right with God. And the patience of the Lord that has kept him from returning as of yet. He knows there are people still willing to turn to him for salvation, even though it seems harder and harder to find them in America. They're finding them in a lot of other places overseas, much more than here in America. But the day will eventually come when the last person to respond positively will do so. And then the trumpet will sound. Don't you dare allow yourself to experience end time burnout like is happening with so many evangelicals. Especially just when things are really starting to get interesting. I mean, I've been preaching on Bible prophecy for the last 45 years, studying Bible prophecy, and it's the most interesting time that we've ever seen. There's nothing like this 45 years ago. Jesus coming for a church that is anxiously watching and waiting for his return. I mean, you don't believe that? Go back and read the 10 virgin parable. Mm-hmm. What did Jesus call those that let their lamp go out and weren't watching? Said they were foolish. Absolutely foolish. He called us to watch. To look up. Especially all the more as we saw things really starting to get interesting like they are right now. Folks, the way my health has been recently, if I honestly thought it was going to be another 100 years before the Lord came back for his church, I'd probably give you my resignation and retire tomorrow. I've been pastoring now for 44 years. That's a long time to do anything. But my expectation of the Lord's coming is greater than it has ever been. And if at all possible, I still want to be preaching the message of the coming of the Lord when the Lord returns for his church. If at all possible. Now, I've got to tell you that in my gut, it feels to me like it's going to be real soon. Or like I said, I just go ahead and retire. You know, I'm allowed to retire. I'm past retirement age now. Way past it now. I'm 66 now. in my gut. I can't do anything but this if I can still stand here.
That's right. Amen.
And like I said a while back, I would hate to go to heaven and have the Lord say, couldn't you held out for a few more months? I needed you down there. There are many people preaching like I'm preaching these days, folks, in case you haven't noticed, and most of you haven't noticed because you show up to hear me every week, which is good. Some years ago, Linda and I were up in Erie steelhead fishing, and I'd go steelhead fishing in the morning, and she'd sleep till noon, eat breakfast in bed, and then when I'd come home from steelhead fishing, I'd get in the hot tub in the room, and then we'd get ready and go out to dinner, and I'd take her shopping for the night. And we thought that was a great vacation. And so we were eating dinner at the Golden Corral restaurant in Erie this one evening. And a friend of ours that we hadn't seen for some time, Reverend Maine Minnick, just happened to be in there too, and he spied us before he left. And he walked over to our table, and as we talked, he said that a number of people at some kind of meeting on the Pittsburgh district had just asked him, how come Nazarene preachers don't preach on the second coming anymore? Like they used to. He said to them, I bet I know one that still is, meaning me. And then he said, you still are, aren't you? I said, you betcha. I'm glad I didn't disappoint him. As long as I'm able, I will continue to preach the glorious message that the King is indeed coming.
Amen.
But don't you dare allow yourself to experience end time burnout before he gets here. Keep looking up, and you won't be disappointed. I guarantee you. You won't be disappointed. So you die before he comes. Okay. Well, that's what we're looking for anyway, is to go to heaven. Whether we go by death or by up through the cloud. We win either way. What do you got to lose if you keep looking up and you go home before it happens? But some of us may still be here. Probably will still be here when that trumpet sounds. And up through the clouds we go. And then there will be a whole bunch of people, though, that will be left behind. Waylon, I never asked you to do this. Could you come and sing that song one more time for us? If you got enough wind left before we close. As an invitation, I know it might take him a moment to get it ready. But I haven't heard that song for a while. You need to sing it a while. Put it right on, right here when he comes up. Right, come on. He'll be up in just a second. Maybe we'll just use that as an invitation this morning. And if you're here this morning and you're not ready for the King to come, my desire to all of you would be, I wish we all would be ready. Let's stand together, whether Waylon will come to the pulpit and sing it here. We'll sing it there. Okay. That'll be fun. If you're here this morning and you're not ready, listen to the words. The altar is open, as he sings. Thank you.
guns and war. All of us got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold. Piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. Wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you've been left behind. A man and wife asleep in bed. She hears a noise and turns her head. He's gone. I wish we'd all been ready. Two men walking up a hill. One disappears and one left standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come and you been left
gave you, whatever it was, but I guarantee you, the worst, absolutely the worst day of your life will be the day when the trumpet sounds and you don't go with the crowd that's disappearing. Instead, you'll be left behind. I wouldn't wish that on my worst enemy. I pray that every single person here this morning will be ready, if you're alive when that day comes. But the only way to be ready is to make sure you know Jesus as your Savior, and to make sure you're living right, and to make sure you're watching also for His coming. If there's anyone here before we leave, anyone that you're not ready, the altar is open. We would encourage you to seek the Lord while He may be found, because the time will come when it is too late. When the church disappears, well, You know, there are lots of debate about what's going to happen during the tribulation, whether the person will be able to get right with God or not. But one thing I know for sure, you'll be here and have to deal with the Antichrist and have to deal with everything that comes along. All the terrible things the Bible says that will happen when the wrath of God is poured out on this earth. And I don't want to be around to face that. Not when we can be at home at the marriage supper of the Lamb, safe and secure. And if you miss that great day, there won't be nobody to blame for it but you. Because right here this morning, you had an opportunity to get right with God. Anyone before we go? Thank you all. I wish all our loved ones would be ready. With not a soul looking around, every head bowed, every eye closed, how many can say, Pastor, as far as I know, not a doubt or a sin that stands between me and God, I am ready for that day. Slip your hand up if you know that for sure. Thank God for so many that can. But if you didn't, I pray that you'll find a place of prayer real, real soon while the opportunity is still here. Let's join our hearts together in a closing word of prayer. Ron, would you please dismiss us with prayer?